join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like you to also join me in a moment of silence. Thank you.
I'd like to call this meeting to order. Roll call.
All members present.
Motion to approve the minutes.
So moved.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Adoption of the agenda. Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Not. Motion passes. I'd like to go to administrative reports.
Thank you, President Graham. In an effort to improve student achievement, which we were charged with by the board last year, we're taking a look at expanding course offerings in the secondary building and in the process of examining options for the high school and middle school to operate as one campus. This concept is in its infancy. The process is underway with building and department leaders, including teachers. We started gathering information this past week, and an opportunity for the community to have input and to address concerns or share concerns and ask questions will be provided during the Meet the Superintendent on October 18th at 6:30 p.m. in the secondary library. All three building principals will join Dr. Bensel in answering questions and seeking input. Together, we will continue to redefine the Viking experience. Thank you.
You. Any other administrative reports? Saying what's listed. Special presentations. Mr. Christensen.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. I'm George Christensen. I apologize for not being here last Friday. It was about 9:30 and I got out of class. But I'm here to ask for your consideration of a LERTA application. LERTA, as most of you know, is basically a form of encouragement to build industrial property. You have a number of LERTAs here, and very simply what a LERTA does, and I've given a copy of the LERTA resolution. I hope that everyone has it. If not, I'll be happy to provide it. This has been adopted by Union Township. Union Township has said, very simply, we are zoning this piece of ground for the purposes of industrial development. LERTA adds to the fact that you can get industry to come in. It is an initial tax break, but quite frankly, in the long term, it benefits the school district. But we can sit and argue about that issue off and on for a long, long time. You've developed at least 7 LERTA buildings in the area of 81 and 78. For all practical purposes, the last one that I was in, the last two I've been involved with, last one I was involved with has developed a 430,000 square foot building, and that assessment came in at $12 million. During the course of the LERTA, as the resolution clearly indicates, nobody can challenge they can't challenge the value of the property. The county assessor has been basically establishing a roughly $25 a square foot on all of these buildings. So at 400,000 square feet, you'll end up with about a $10 million assessment.
Council order application and resolution says, first year you get 10%, 20%, and on up. I did not bring with me, but I'm sure that your financial manager can tell you the number of dollars that you've gotten from ARPA. The property in question is a 30-acre tract which sits next to Wardenville Road. I have maps which I can gladly orient you to, but if you don't know, Wardenville Road runs very close to 81 at the end of Old Ford where it comes through the new road that came through. This was and is in Clinton Green at the present time, and your tax revenues from it are approximately $3,000 a year. Even at 10%, you're going to more than quadruple that number the first year. This piece of ground sits and has to be connected with water and sewer, and the LERTA application has been provided and approved by the township. The county will take formal action on it, but this is a request to you to allow this to go into the LERTA program. I can tell you that we've been working on this project for some period of time. I can tell you that your approval probably will move forward on the building of this, if not by fall, by next spring. They do have a tenant for it. It is 390 to 410,000 square feet. The map, which I have, I don't know who can see it here, but this is the new road, Ford Road, that comes from basically Fisher Avenue here, past Lowe's gas station, and this is the Sid Tool building. There's a building there at the present time, which is the last one that has been constructed. 30 acres is a little piece of ground which sits up here. It sits between 78 and Ordnersville Road. And that is the application. If somebody has any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer them. I'll be glad to review the map and the identification, but you do have the resolution. Just appreciate the consideration of it. If any questions you have, I'll be happy to answer them.
I just have one. Is there a timeline? Are you under a timeline for this?
I am somewhat under a timeline, yes. My world doesn't come to an end, okay? But as you know, all timelines happen. I'm hopeful that you approve it this evening. If you don't, you tell me when it is. I'll work with whatever, try and work with whatever you want. I was not here last week, and I can't ask you to hurry up for something that I not go for.
How is it on the agenda?
So, you're not asking us to change zoning for this?
That's the township. I just related that we had to change the zoning because this is really the only piece that could be connected with water and sewer. No, that has been changed. That's the township.
Because if it was clean and green, that means it's like agriculture and not
It wasn't in agriculture, but it was in clean and green, which means that the tax revenue which you get goes down by about 80%.
Okay. So it is zoned industrial?
It's zoned industrial. It's zoned. That's all been completed. And the management plans have all been, the rules of management plans have been approved by the township. Now, I'm just asking you, I wanted to relate what had been transpired. No, I'm just asking you to follow through with what the township did so that we can
put it over. And provide an estimated amount of jobs it's going to bring into the area?
The estimated jobs are 21 at that point in time, sir. I could give you an estimate of what was given to me. The lowest priced job will be $16.50 an hour, and there should be three jobs which should be in six figures. That's what you're getting to say.
Mr. Christensen. Unfortunately, since you weren't here last week.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. Unfortunately, since you weren't here last week, we didn't put it on the agenda because we didn't hear your presentation, but we're willing to add it this evening. So I'd like to make a motion to add that item to order request from Donald Smith. Second.
Discussion? Discussion?
And then we'll add that as item J under management.
Well, all in favor of adding it to as item J under management, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes.
So the motion will read as J under management, move to approve the request from Donald Smith. So with that, Mr. Park.
Thank you, Mr. Christensen. Next will be a presentation on what a forensic audit is by Lisa Myers, Lawyer and Ritter, LLC.
Okay, well, thank you. I'm Lisa Myers, and with me tonight is Jordan Heilman and Emily Griffith, and they are part of the Lawyer and Ritter Forensic Litigation Consulting Team. So we put together a little PowerPoint for you, a few slides, just to kind of stay focused here. So our objectives tonight are to introduce Lawyer and Ritter to you, because you may not know who we are, to help define or educate the difference between a forensic statement audit and a forensic examination, to examine those differences, and then to review what do the folks in the Forensic Litigation Support Consulting Group, what's our training, what are our designations, what are our licenses, and what do we kind of do for a living? And then one of the services that has transpired from this group is internal process assessment services. So we just thought we'd talk on that just quickly. So we don't have a lot of slides. We're just going to kind of go through here. It's an education system or session, which I think is appropriate since we're in a school district. So first of all, who are we? Who's Boyer and Ritter? Well, we are a regional accounting firm located, headquarters is in Camp Hill, Pennsylvania. We're the oldest CPA firm in the Harrisburg area. We've been around since 1926. And so we're a regional accounting firm. We have about bodies in our firm. We have about 115 individuals that we employ. That's not full-time equivalents, but full-time equivalents, we're about 94, 95. But we're still, we're still a public accounting firm. So we have niches, you know, but we still have tax season for many people. You know, they do that January to April 15th thing. We don't do that. But we have many, many areas. So we work in audit. We have a practice group that's in the auto dealership group. We have about 200 auto dealerships across the East Coast. Construction, we and real estate. We have manufacturing. We have trucking. You know, we have a tax practice that is a practice group. And then what I used to do. So I've been with the firm almost. I'm an owner. I'm one of the owners. And Jordan and Emily are employees of the firm. And before I became an owner, I kind of did everything. I was very diverse. I started out with taxation. I did all kinds of, you know, dealerships, construction, all those types of things. And then in about 2007, my career changed. And it had something to do with Lebanon County. And I kind of stumbled upon a white-collar crime, and that's kind of how I rolled into forensic litigation support and consulting. So as you know, our services are varied. What I did with my career was said, okay, well, there's not always fraud going on. I mean, there is one fraud out there, and not everybody understands what fraud is. But what we've also done from the forensic side is we've said, okay, how can we also be proactive and help clients? So some of the things that we're going to talk about tonight are proactive. It doesn't mean you have fraud in your organization, but how can you look at your controls and your processes and your efficiencies and say, okay, how can I get stronger and be a better organization? And this is for-profit, non-profit, or governmental, regardless, okay? So first of all, Emily's going to talk a little about an external financial statement, because every year, you're probably in the middle of right now, your auditors, you have a CPA firm, independent auditors, that you engage each year, and they are in doing the audit of your financial statements. That audit has to be over to PDE by the end of this month, right? So what is that? You know, what are they really doing? What are those folks, those auditors in here doing? So Emily's going to kind of talk about that right now.
So you're clearly more familiar with the external financial statement audit. During this, an independent audit firm will come in, and they'll review your financial statements and reporting docs for those financial statements. They'll look over those and provide an opinion on the financial statements to see if they're fairly presented. And they'll usually look at a fine time, usually a year. And during that, they'll try to obtain reasonable assurance to try to figure out their opinion. So the reasonable assurance, it's not absolute assurance. They cannot guarantee that there's no fraud or that they're completely fairly presented, because we have such things that we use like sampling. We're only going to look at a very small part of your reporting doc and financial statements. And that's figured out through the process. So we use sampling and we figure out materiality during this audit.
So financial statements, so when your auditors come in and they present, they're presenting at a point in time, and your fiscal year ends June 30th. So when you look at your balance sheet, they're going to say, okay, we have cash of $2 million. They say, yes, you either have cash of $2 million or you don't, right? That's their opinion. Well, what we do, and we'll talk more about this, from a forensic, we say, should it be $200,000? Should it be $20 million? We're looking at the processes and all the controls that are around that cash. They're looking at a point in time and opining on that number. Okay, so it's different. And like Emily talked about, it's a sample. They're not really assessing from cradle to grave. We're looking at how your operations from a forensic standpoint, and we're looking at 100% of the transactions, not a sample. Forensic examination, I kind of segued into that. Jordan's going to talk about that for a moment.
So as Lisa and Emily have stated, your regular auditors annually, forensic examinations, that's something that typically occurs whenever there's suspicion of fraud occurring or there might be a tip-off somewhere. It's something that's requested of us to come in and do at one point in time. A little bit more different from a regular financial statement audit, like Lisa stated, is that, so say the person that you're a little suspicious of has worked here for 3 years, you're like, well, I'm not really sure if they started this from the beginning of their employment or if it's a rather new thing that we stumbled on. We will come in and ask you, you know, what's your suspicion period? What do you want us to look at? From that point, we'll look at, so say 2014. We'll start in 2014 and look at your accounts and say, well, this is where your weak spots were. This is where you could have been exposed to having some fraudulent activity occurred. And we'll gather supporting documentation to literally support every transaction in that period that pertains to those items. So say you have someone collecting lunch money, a parent calls in, hey, why is my kid not able to get this? I sent a check in last week. Well, there's a tip off, okay, well, why is this money missing? So you see what that person has access to, we'll come in and look at your bank statement, we'll look at your deposits, canceled checks, just to determine your weaknesses, and then where money might have went missing. Now, we won't put an opinion on anything with a forensic examination. What we mainly do there is we'll say, like, based on what we looked at, we can assume or reasonably state that X amount might have been taken, or that these are your weak spots in your improvement. But we can't give an opinion on whether or not the person was stealing the money. That's not the forensic side of things. So
well, that's not our side of things. That's up to the judge and the jury. So when we prepare our reports, because every time we go in and we do an investigation, so say a client were to hire us to do, and we are hired through the attorneys, when it's specifically forensics. Now, we're just doing, and we'll talk about this, a process improvement, you know, you could hire us for that. But we are hired by the attorneys because there's going to be an attorney-client privilege on that work document, okay? That we can talk to the attorneys, we can talk to you, it's non-discoverable. So that's how we would run our investigations. When we're done with our report, we do not say this person committed fraud. That is only up to the judge and the jury to define that and to decide that. What we do is we state the facts. And then you have, you know, you would be prosecuting that. So usually, I will tell you, we don't go to trial a lot. 98% of the time, they settle out of court because it's black and white. We have the evidence. It's nailed down. Now, what you went through a few years ago, back in 2007, which I don't know if you all lived here at that time, we had the facts for a certain amount of that embezzlement, that white-collar crime, and then the entity in Lebanon County was able to recoup that through insurance. So some of the things that we're looking at, too, when we're doing the process is, so just to kind of quick here, this is a good scenario for you between external financial statements and forensic. So just kind of keep in your mind, external, what your independent auditors are doing, they're going to opine on your financial statements. They're opining on that statement saying it's either unmodified, modified, adverse, you know, or disclaimer. That's going to your banks, your bonding agencies, and PE. They want that document, okay? They're getting reasonable assurance. It's a defined period of time, July 1st, 2016 to June 30th, 2017, right? That's what they're working on now. And they're using sample methods. Forensics, first of all, we're looking at fraud allegations or signs of fraud. I had one in a school district where it was as simple as they thought somebody in this school district was stealing money out of the soda machine. Okay, well, how do I prove that? How do I prove that? So what we did was we went back and said, okay, before that person worked here, here's what the money was that was coming in and was being deposited. Then that person came in. So the deposits were, and this was a relatively big school district. It wasn't like a soda, but it was a water and milk and all that kind of stuff, right? We don't have soda. But it was a machine. So it's $2,000 a day. Well, then that person comes along and those deposits dropped out to $500 a day. Then that person is put on administrative leave and the deposits go back up to $2,000 a day. So what can we show? We can show a trend that during that time period, right, something was askew. And then it's up to the judge and the jury to define and the prosecutors. We're going to show those types of things. Sometimes it's as clear as, yep, I have a check here that didn't belong to you. You wrote it out to yourself for consulting reasons, you know? And there you go, or whatever it is, we can find checks. We have right now a case we're working on where unfortunately an individual had a caregiver and the individual stole money from the caregiver because she was legally blind. And so she used her credit card, she wiped out her checking accounts, she had, you know, and we have all that documentation. So it's a different, it's more of a, you know, it's more finite, we have more information, and we're looking at that entire period. So this individual wanted us to look at a two-year window. We said, show us your transactions the year before so we can prove that they weren't purchases, right? So we're saying, here's how this individual typically bought things, then all of a sudden, you know, she might have shopped at Target once a year and spent $100. Now all of a sudden, she's shopping there every month and spending $500. That's not normal activity. And so in our litigation support department, we're looking, we do fraud, we do litigation support. Lots of times there'll be companies that come in and they'll say, all right, we believe someone, there's damage is caused by somebody. So we're working either for the plaintiff or the defendant. We go into companies and do a business risk assessment. That many times we're going to a process improvement where we're looking at an area, like at a college or university. We may look at their financial aid. We may look at their procurement, their bursar's office, things like that. Or in any organization, we do dealerships. We're looking at all of those types of things. We also do SOC engagements, and that's where a third party, you've outsourced, like I think in Lebanon, you have your earned income taxes are being collected by Keystone, right? Keystone Collection Group. We perform the SOC audit for Keystone Collection Group. So we are auditing Keystone on behalf of you guys because you're external, you have outsourced the collection of earned income taxes, which is a huge amount of money on your financial statements. So we go out and we audit Keystone and out in Irwin, and we audit through their IT system and through their financial processes to make sure that the money that you are getting, first of all, is your money, and are you getting all of your money? And then we've also performed interim CFO positions because with all the people that are baby boomers that are retiring, this is kind of like a new crisis in accounting in the finance world. There's not enough coming in to replace all those who are retiring. And so for the internal processes, Emily, why don't you walk us through here? Because this is a spinoff. So when we're not doing fraud and all those other things, we said, how can we help organizations be proactive with their operations? And this is where the internal process assessment services came from.
So for internal process assessments, we'll come in, kind of set a baseline, talk to the people within those processes, and see how it's all laid out currently. Then we'll kind of look over and see where we can improve. Usually it's for improvement of internal controls, but you also get these nice little add-ins when you do improve internal controls. I know that we did internal process improvements for another agency, and we realized that not only were we improving their internal controls, but saving them a lot of money. They were doing something very antiquated and spending, I think it was $60,000 when they could take out all those people that were performing that one duty, put them somewhere more efficient, and they could go to a completely electronic service that way and save around $60,000. So you can streamline the processes for this, increase productivity, make better use of your people, and for sure, reduce costs.
And many times in the nonprofits and the governments that we're working with, as people are retiring, they're not replacing those individuals. So those organizations have to become more streamlined and more efficient. And so they may have, you know, they will move the workload around, but then they don't step back and look at the controls that are now in place, and they give access to folks that shouldn't have access to everything. So what we will do is we will audit through their IT system as well as externally and say, okay, is everybody who has access to this, is that working correctly so that we're going to mitigate the risk of fraud or corruption within that organization? That's a lot of information, but hopefully we were able to educate you a little bit. Are there any questions we could address relatively quickly for you? No? Okay, well, thank you for the opportunity to present. And so if you do think of anything, I left my business card on your desk or in your area, and you're welcome to shoot me an email, text me, or give me a call. Okay? Thank you for your time. Have a great night.
Thank you very much. High school student of the month for October. High school students of the month for October are Romina Boyd and Jenna Wentling. This award is sponsored jointly by the Fredericksburg and Jonestown Lions Club, and each recipient will be recognized as a future leader of the Lions Club. The middle school student of the month for September is Sachi Patel. This award is sponsored by the Northern Lebanon Rotary Club, and each recipient will be recognized at a future meeting of the Rotary Club. And now we'd like to have our special representative to the board, Lindsay Kaiser.
Okay, so first, the marching band had older students and student leaders write out cards to individual school board members. You can find those at your places. The main point in them is an invitation to the Lebanon County Marching Exhibition Show, which will be held at our high school on October 21st. The exact time is to be announced. Our mini-thon is in their fourth year of fundraising for Four Diamonds. In the past 3 years, they have raised just shy of $60,000 for fighting pediatric cancer at the Hershey Medical Center. This year's mini-thon will be held in April, and their fundraising goal is $20,000. Mr. Koval asked me to mention that he wants to look into starting a new law enforcement or emergency response club for students that are interested in going into those careers. Our volunteer club is planning on collecting winter coats and blankets this fall, as they have in previous years. On December 10th, they'll be serving a Christmas meal at the Lebanon Rescue Mission. And on December 19th, they'll be serving at multiple soup kitchens to which they'll give the collected items. The student council service Saturday for September, held on the 23rd, we had a group of 10 students go to the animal shelter in Gersenpurs. Over an hour, they mulched 16 cubic yards of mulch in an exercise area for the dogs. They waterproofed the outside of the kennels and painted. And the next service Saturday will be on November 4th. Regarding homecoming, it's this week. The dance will be on Saturday, and our football game will be Friday. Our court will be presented. Last month, I'd said that Powerpuff was tomorrow, but I was mistaken. It's tonight. And that concludes my presentation.
Thank you, Lindsay. Lindsay, did you run out and go to the Powerpuff? Are you on the team? Again, thank you for that report. Any old business on the board? We have two requests to address the board. They are both non-agenda items. So we will get the meeting. We will go to Director Sell and the agenda, consensus agenda.
Discussion. All right.
there's no discussion, just would like to mention that that from what I was not at the actual meeting, but from what I understand and how this would facilitate both the board members' ability to search for policies, documents, as well as the administrative department. I see some huge benefits for a relatively minor cost. Discussion? If not, let's call the vote.
Kelly wants to speak.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. I turned myself off. I was actually going to say I enjoyed the presentation. It is something that I would like to see us investigate more fully, possibly implement in the future. But I would like to see this tied to the budget process moving forward.
Thank you, Kelly. Okay. Call the vote.
England?
Yes.
Wolf?
No.
Edmund?
No.
Sal?
Yes.
Bray?
Yes.
Klein?
Yes.
Erdman?
Yes.
Sicali?
No.
Murray?
Yes.
Six yes, three no.
I move item E, the agreement with Empower the Mind.
Second.
Discussion?
I can't remember from last week. Is this something new that we're doing or we're always doing?
This is just a renewal of an existing agreement. And there's no cost to the district for this. You do your job.
Yes, ma'am. Any other discussion? If not, let's call the vote.
Wolf?
Yes.
Heckman?
Yes.
Sal?
Yes.
Bray?
Yes.
Klein?
Yes.
Erdman?
Yes.
Sicali?
Yes.
Murray?
Yes.
England?
Yes.
All in favor?
I move item F, the final adoption of the transportation kindergarten guideline policy 810.
Second.
Discussion? I would like to just make a brief comment, just to clarify what this is going to do. Our policy currently states that if a child is left, it goes to their bus stop in the afternoon or at noon, and there's nobody there, they're taken back to the school. But if that, and this is only for kindergarten, but at the end of the day, there's nobody there for the kindergarten child. The kindergarten child is left off at that bus stop, or at least that's our policy, although it doesn't always happen that way. But this corrects that, in our opinion, that the kindergartner, whether they get off at noon or later in the afternoon, if there is nobody there to pick them up, they will be taken back to the school and then watched until somebody can come and pick them up. So that's what we're voting on this evening, is to change that and amend that policy to make it correct. Okay, so let's call the vote.
Ekman?
Yes.
Sal?
Yes.
Bray?
Yes.
Klein?
Yes.
Erdman?
Yes.
Sicali?
Yes.
Murray?
Yes.
England?
Yes.
Wolf?
Yes.
All in favor?
I move item G, which is approval of the position description for certified instructional assistant.
Second.
Discussion?
I just wanted to ask, I do have the description. That's all we're voting on tonight, right? Not the cost?
No, it's just the job description.
Okay. Yes.
It's not fulfilling a position or hiring somebody in that. It's just in an event that we would want to utilize that position in the future. We already have the job description. since it's a new job description.
The cost would be to be determined.
That's correct, yes.
Any other discussion? If not, let's call the vote.
Sal?
Yes.
Gray?
Yes.
Klein?
Yes.
Erdman?
Yes.
Sicali?
Yes.
Murray?
Yes.
England?
Yes.
Wolf?
Yes.
Heckman?
Yes.
All in favor?
I move item H, the long-term professional substitute elementary counselor.
Second.
Discussion?
I wish I had caught this last week, and I didn't, and I don't know why, I just skipped over it. I know we need this, but I am so scared on the priorities list, district-wide. Was it in the budget, or is this kind of like a special ed section, or is there, or is this completely new coming out the gate?
What was discussed, this position does three things. One, it takes care of servicing gifted. It also then allows the guidance lessons in elementary school, and then it also fulfills an outstanding grievance that we are obligated to take care of.
And in our budget last year, we had a certain amount set aside, I have to remember how much, and we did not spend all of that, and that was for things such as this.
Thank you, that's what I was trying to just,
yeah.
Should have asked last week, didn't you see it, don't you see it?
Rachel, I don't know what you're talking about.
Can you explain?
Because we had a certain amount put aside for
curriculum
and director of curriculum, and we did not end up using all of that amount.
So that's why it's a long-term set position this year. And then you would, if we want to make the recommendation for it to be a consistent position, then we would make
that. That is part of the budget.
That's over next year, which is why it's in as a long-term set position.
It's kind of like leftover funds.
Correct. So from the curriculum standpoint, it does address that with the guidance lessons.
And also addresses IEP with the curriculum that will play a good part for IEP progressing.
I don't want to put Mr. Heckman on the spot, but I think he has this information at his fingertips. I think I do too, but I just want to verify. So last year we set aside a certain amount of money for assistant superintendent.
What was the other terminology?
Curriculum director.
Okay, and we. Okay.
And reading supplies, when we were talking about that, we put that in as general.
Okay.
We wanted to.
It was like 200,000.
Okay. It was 200?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So then we have a different position, but Mr. Scosian's position would be that director of
special services, right?
So that would be at a total cost of, I'm just making sure that there really is $68,000 or whatever it is, dollars left.
I can't sit here and say for sure that there's $66,806 left over out of that 200. I don't want to get into all the details, especially the personnel today, but the salary that is set aside, the hiring was done for less than what was set aside, so there's that amount at least that's there, along with the benefits that go along with that salary. I don't recall offhand how much was put in for curriculum to help make up that 200,000. But there is at least some set aside, yes. But I can't tell you the full amount.
Okay, that was what I was trying to figure out, that actually was that amount enough to cover that. It doesn't quite look like that to me. And then the 66,000, that would be for that person's salary, but
salary
then.
And
okay.
But it's prorated, correct? This isn't
yes,
the prorated
amount.
It right, would actually
66,000
be less.
66,000 is for an entire year.
Yes.
And that would include your salary, social security, health insurance, television, all of that. Workers' comp. Of course, anytime you make these type of predictions or estimates or costs, you may end up hiring somebody more or at a higher cost or at a lower cost. So it's just an estimate, it's just a best guess at this point in time until the actual hiring takes place.
I guess I just didn't, last week when it was brought up, well, it wasn't brought up, when it was on here, I was surprised to see it. And I know that we have a long wish list, and I just didn't know how we specifically came, or who specifically came to this idea. So I am really excited to have additional staff. I just don't know, nobody's explained to me why this is it, because I know a lot of, the administration has a wish list of other staff members. And I don't know where this is exactly coming from.
Thank you.
I think a big, what Dr. Renzel said last week was, this is part of the grievance, and this settles that grievance, because something had to be done in order to fix that problem. So I think that was a big part of the reason why it needed to be now, as opposed to waiting on our next budget.
Any other discussion? Not, let's call a vote.
Yes.
Erdman.
Yes.
Isakalik.
Yes.
Murray.
Yes.
Palin.
Yes.
Wolf.
Yes.
Ekman.
No.
Stell.
Yes.
Gray.
Yes.
8 yes, 1 no. Motion carried.
I move item I, which is the agreement for Easy Pay third party, which will allow parents to pay online for meals.
Second.
Discussion? Call the vote.
Erdman.
Yes.
Sikalvin.
Yes.
Murray.
Yes.
Anglin.
Yes.
Wolf.
Yes.
Ekman.
Yes.
Snell.
Yes.
Gray.
Yes.
Klein.
Yes.
All in favor.
I move item J that was recently added, which is to approve the lawyer request from Donald Smith.
Second.
Discussion? Call the vote.
Sikalik.
Yes.
Murray.
Yes.
Anglin.
Yes.
Wolf.
Yes.
Ekman.
Yes.
Sal.
Yes.
Gray.
Yes.
Klein.
Yes.
Erdman.
Yes.
All in favor.
Thank you, Director Sal. Director Anglin, Programs Committee.
I move item A, which is the final adoption of the library and creative writing curriculum.
Second.
Discussion? Call the vote.
Murray.
Yes.
Anglin.
Yes.
Wolf.
Yes.
Ekman.
Yes.
Sell.
Yes.
Gray.
Yes.
Klein.
Yes.
Erdman.
Yes.
Sikalik.
Yes.
All in favor.
I move item B, which is to approve the listed coaches.
Second.
Discussion? Call the vote.